going to get started a few minutes early. Thanks, everybody, for joining us today. We have a special talk today that is an endowed memorial lecture in palliative care and bioethics. We are very grateful for Mrs. Eleanor Trowbridge for making a request to the Berman Institute to establish this semi-annual lecture in palliative care. Palliative care was an issue of great importance to her, and we're really pleased to be able to continue the conversation. Ellie, as she was known, devoted a lot of her time to Hopkins, and some of you in the room may have known her. In addition to serving on the Berman Bioethics Board, she chaired the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health's Council on Population and Family Growth. She also worked for many years in the development office and as a development consultant for both the Children's Defense Fund and Population Action International. Sometime in the 80s, she began to work for the oncology department to raise money for them. Her work took on deeply personal significance when her daughter, Sheila Hutzler Reeves, for whom this lecture is named, got a diagnosis of breast cancer and ultimately died. We, again, are so very grateful that Ms. Trowbridge made this request to establish the Sheila Hutzler Reeves Memorial Lecture. I'm very excited, and we are all very lucky today, to have Dr. Kathleen Meert be our speaker for the day. Dr. Meert is a professor of pediatrics at Wayne State University and chief of the Division of Pediatric Critical Care Medicine at Children's Hospital of Michigan in Detroit. She is a principal investigator for the Eunice Kennedy Shriver National Institute of Child Health and ICHD and Human Development Collaborative Pediatric Critical Care Research Network. She has a special interest in end-of-life and family bereavement care in the PICU and has multiple publications in that area. I was telling Dr. Meert that I first became aware of her work very early on in my own research career when she first authored the paper called Ethical and Logistical Considerations of Multicenter Parental Bereavement Research. She and her co-authors in that paper really laid out a framework for respectful and rigorous research that both minimized distress for a vulnerable population of bereaved parents and maximized the chances that what parents would tell us in the course of that research might really go on to help other families. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Kathleen Meert.
So honored to be here. I feel like I'm a little bit far away, but I'm going to stand here because if I don't, I'll have to turn my back to you to look at the slides. Okay, so if anyone can hear me, I'll raise your hand and I'll speak up. My talk today, I really tried to focus it on the literature and make it evidence-based. I'll talk a little bit about my own experience, as Dr. Boss has said, about conducting research with bereaved parents in the intensive care unit, but I want to bring in the literature and not to report to you the findings of bereavement research, but more on the process and the methods. And some authors have taken the time to write about the process and the methods. So first we'll ask the question, why are bereaved individuals included in research? So sometimes it's to give feedback on palliative care programs and end-of-life care for their loved ones. For example, the person who is dying or in palliative care, they might be too sick, they might be too fatigued, they might not want to put up with the burdens of research. So their family members during bereavement are asked as proxies to comment on the patient's care. Another reason would be to enhance understanding of bereavement and to examine the efficacy and safety of bereavement interventions. Sometimes bereaved individuals are asked to participate in research to provide insight into prevention. So for example, if you're a suicide researcher, you're going to have to work with bereaved individuals to try to understand the circumstances of suicide. Or in pediatrics, if you're a researcher on sudden infant death syndrome, you're going to have to interact with bereaved parents to try to understand the circumstances of what happened to the infant. And sometimes bereaved individuals are asked to participate in research in the error. And we'll talk a little bit about this. This may be, for example, cancer survivorship research, or it may be follow-up research from an intensive care unit. Is bereavement research sensitive research? Well, sensitive research has the potential to harm the participant, the researcher, and society. It typically examines taboo topics or things that may cause discomfort or distress to people. And it often involves vulnerable or disadvantaged participants. So we need to think about vulnerability when we're thinking about conducting research with bereaved individuals. Vulnerability in research, really, we're talking about whether the individual has difficulty providing voluntary informed consent due to limited decision-making capacity, situational factors, or being at particular risk for exploitation. So when we think about bereaved individuals, they're not one of the typical vulnerable groups our IRBs might think about, such as prisoners or employees or children or pregnant women. But there are some things to consider. So as far as decision-making capacity, the majority of the evidence there in the literature would suggest that bereaved individuals are capable of deciding whether or not to participate in research. And in fact, they want the opportunity to decide for themselves. There is a potential for harm, and as investigators, we have to realize that. The potential is really emotional pain and distress. I mean, people are asked to think back about their experiences with their loved one around the time of that person's death. And if, particularly with parents, parental grief is particularly intense and prolonged and has been associated with adverse mental and physical health outcomes. So there is that potential for harm. And of course, it is a sensitive research topic if people are talking about their very personal experiences with their friends or family members. So what does this mean? That we need very careful attention to design and methods that are sensitive to our participants' needs. So I think we would all agree that research that is asking an irrelevant question or that is scientifically unsound would be unethical research. So our goal really is to achieve the right balance between relevant questions, rigorous methods, and participant burden. So let's think about what motivates a bereaved person to participate in research. Altruism is a big motivator. This is particularly true in working with bereaved parents as I do. So the bereaved person may want to contribute to research, to advance medical knowledge. They might want to help other bereaved people. They may want to increase awareness of a disease or a condition, particularly what their loved one died from. Sometimes bereaved individuals want to participate in research because they want to vent. They want to have a chance to talk about their experiences and tell their story. This is also very true of parents. Parents often, their child has died, intensive care units, they go home, the family wants them to move on. They really have no one to really to talk to about their experiences. Sometimes a bereaved will participate in research to try to gain insight, to make sense of their experience or find meaning in their experience. Sometimes they look at research as a way to gain help or support for themselves and their family members. Sometimes it's a private feedback. Sometimes feedback professionals want to hear, and sometimes health professionals don't want to hear. Sometimes it's gratitude, or sometimes it's a bereaved may participate in research to avoid abandonment. Okay, there's a body of literature that suggests that, particularly in intensive care settings, with parents, their child's in the intensive care unit, the child dies, the parents are very bonded to the bedside nurse, the physician's taking care of that child. And when the child dies, the parents go home and they may never see those people again. So sometimes people will participate in research to reconnect with the hospital or with the health professionals that have taken care of their child and avoid that sense of abandonment. Sometimes people participate because they're trying to choose as they think their loved one would have died. And sometimes people can't give a reason, and it's just because. And I do have to say we need a little bit of caution there because sometimes, particularly with working with parents, one parent might participate at the urging of the other. So we always want to make sure that participation is voluntary. Now, how do bereaved people perceive research participation? So I wanted to make this evidence-based. I have a lot of studies listed on this slide, and I'm not going to go through all of them, but we can look at a couple of them. These are studies of bereaved parents whose children died of various causes, different countries around the world, different study designs. If we just look at the first one by step, these are parents whose child died of Ewing sarcoma. 98% were glad they participated in the research. 47% expected it would be painful, but none regretted participation. I'll just take another one, Tanija, 2007 from the United States. These are parents whose child died suddenly and unexpectedly. 87% reported research participation to be not at all or a little stressful. 92% said they would participate again. Perceived stress was not associated with the willingness to participate. So I can tell you if we went through each one of these, and we'll have time with the fellows this afternoon so we can look at them more closely. But overall, parents find the bereavement research experience as positive. And if there is distress, it's short-lived, tends to be during the research itself, and does not cause long-lasting harm. This slide is asking the same question about the perception of the bereaved person participating in research, but these are not parents. So for example, siblings whose brother or sister died of cancer, 84% reported the research experience as positive. Okay. Adults from China and Japan, again, most reported the research experience. One caveat here, though, is that when we're finding out about how to bereave people experience research, we can only ask the people who participated. So we don't really know how do the people feel who said, no, I don't want to participate, and whether is that harmful to them. Okay. But overall, the literature would suggest that bereaved individuals most often report a positive experience on research participation. A minority experience distress, and most distress is brief, occurring during participation, and not long. So how are bereaved individuals identified for research participation? Well, for myself, I'm an intensive care physician and I work at a hospital and I'm working with parents whose children may die in the intensive care unit. So I have access to look at my logs for my intensive care unit. I have access to medical records to identify the children who died, to identify their parents' contact information, and then to reach out to those families. This would be different for a researcher who's not employed by the hospital. Then there may be issues of privacy by having a researcher in and wanting to look at confidential medical records that they wouldn't normally have access to. It's important to realize, however we go about choosing our participants for study, it could introduce bias into our studies and affect the generalizability of our results. So although I study parents whose children died in the ICU environment, my results might not be applicable to parents whose children have died at home and in hospice care. Bereavement support groups are another way that bereavement researchers would recruit bereaved individuals. Here, you know, the bias would be that you're recruiting people who want to attend a bereavement support group, okay? Not everybody does. That doesn't mean that you can't get really good research from it. There's a researcher named Dennis Glass who has written many papers and books about the concept of continuing bonds, or the relationship that parents have with their children after death. And he writes in the beginning of some of his books about how he got into this field by facilitating a bereavement support group called Compassionate Friends. And his writings are really very beautiful. So I think, you know, you just have to realize that there may be bias and some limits to the generalizability depending on where we recruit bereaved individuals. Of course, if we recruit from religious communities, we may be recruiting more religious people. Advocacy groups, such as, you know, groups that are advocating for, you know, better treatments for cancer or sepsis or whatever. Of course, we're going to recruit individuals whose loved one died of those diseases. Some groups have used public records, death records, to recruit bereaved individuals. In one study, in my references by Caserta et al., they were studying actually elderly widows and widowers and were recruiting from public records, meaning death records. Then they had two cities. One they were withdrawing people from, it was two sites in the study. One was Salt Lake City and one was San Francisco. And in Salt Lake City, they really didn't have any trouble recruiting from public records because everything was electronic. When they went to San Francisco, death records were not electronic. They didn't reside centrally. They resided within the different counties. The researchers had to search things manually. They had to pay for every death record they wanted to look at. So there were a lot of impediments there. They ended up supplementing their recruitment in that community with obituaries. Obituaries typically would have the next kin and have a place where the person died, so you might be able to contact them. If you're using death records, you know, even if you have the deceased person's address, you're sending a letter to the home where that person lived, addressed to whom it may concern, but you could see it could be insensitive. Internet is another way to recruit bereaved individuals, so people advertise, for example, on, you know, bereavement support group message boards on the internet and other types of advertising. So if you are recruiting from a hospital or a support group or a religious community, et cetera, you may be able to use more personal methods. If you're recruiting from public records, obituaries, and the internet, it may be a little bit more personal. Now, what is gatekeeping and how might it affect bereavement research? Well, gatekeeping is providing or denying researchers access to potential eligible participants. Okay, now, why might somebody put themselves in that role as gatekeeper or be asked to? One, there's a desire to protect families. So someone in a gatekeeping role might think, you know, we shouldn't contact all bereaved families, only certain ones. There may be a belief, this is often true, that the intervention that's under investigation, obviously it's beneficial, so why does it need to be evaluated? Another is a fear of litigation, and there may be other reasons. I can give you an example in the Collaborative Critical Care Network, one of our bereavement studies. We have 7 sites in our network. One of the hospitals said, well, you can't contact any bereaved parent until our hospital risk management looks over that record. Because they wanted, you know, to know who we were contacting and were fear of litigation. But really, as a researcher, you're not doing this kind of work. You don't want to just go get the happy people. You want the disgruntled people, too, to know how to help them. So remember your recruitment methods can create bias in your sample, compromise generalizability of findings, and gatekeeping in particular interferes with the autonomy of potential participants because you're not even giving them the chance to say no. Somebody else is saying no for them. I'll just briefly go over, this is a case study of 3 recruitment methods using letters. So here the researcher is doing a multi-center study in Australia with bereaved parents. And so they had to apply to different IRBs. And the 3 IRBs gave them each a different way to recruit parents. All 3 used a letter. Now a letter is a very common way to recruit bereaved parents because you can send the letter to the home and introduce the study, and the parents can think about that before they ever come face to face with an investigator. It's just kind of a nice, respectful thing to do. So one of the IRBs let the first method go. The researcher was not employed by the hospital. The researcher looked at the medical records, got the contact information, mailed a letter to the families with an opt-out card. An opt-out card means that the parent sends the card back in only if they never want to hear from this investigator again. So it says, if you never want to hear from me, you can opt out. Send the card back in. There were some privacy issues here, the IRB thought, because it required access to the medical records for screening and contact information. They felt it did respect autonomy because the parents could opt out. It was, the practical issue was very good for the researchers. The researcher had control over recruitment. They could make their own sampling decisions. For example, if they wanted to use proposed sampling and make sure they recruited parents of children with acute illness and chronic disease, or young children and old children, they could do it. They could control the pace of the mailings. The second IRB said, oh no, we can't do that. We'll have a social worker who's already interacting with those bereaved parents introduce the study and ask if their contact information could be shared. So here, okay, it respects privacy, that was a good thing. The problem was there was this existing therapeutic relationship between the social worker and the parents, and that might seem nice, like, well, this is somebody I know asking me, so that's okay. But on the other hand, some of the parents may have had a hard time saying no because they didn't want to threaten that therapeutic relationship. And there was some evidence for this in the study because this particular recruitment method resulted in a lot of passive refusals, meaning people would say yes, give my contact information, I'll participate, and then they were never answered the phone or never responded on the researcher's call. This particular social worker method, the social worker played a gatekeeping role. Recruitment was delayed because the social worker had many competing clinical responsibilities. It wasn't good for the researcher. The researcher was unable to determine eligibility or consent rates. It turned out the social worker didn't even refer all people. If there were families she thought were too distressed, she didn't refer them to the researchers. And this had the lowest of the 3 recruitment methods. The 3rd method, there was a research nurse employed by the hospital. She had access to the medical records. She mailed the letters with what was called an opt-in card. An opt-in card means that the family has to send it back and say, yes, I will, you know, be interested in the research. It respected privacy, respected autonomy. The opt-in approach limited the investigators from being able to follow any type of sampling strategy that they wanted to do. There was no screening of records, and it made it difficult because when you're doing mailings to free families, you usually want to avoid things like birthdays and death dates, which didn't happen. So in this particular study, these researchers took the time to publish and compare and contrast these recruitment methods. They thought that probably the last method respected privacy and autonomy the best, but really was not best for the researchers because they didn't have control. Now, I mentioned a little bit about opt-in and versus opt-out. This is another thing IRBs will talk about when you're doing recruitment research. Should your subject opt-in or opt-out? So this was a study that was a randomized trial of opt-in versus opt-out. And in the opt-out, the bereaved parents got a letter in the mail that explained the study. They got a survey to complete, and they got the opt-out card, which said, if you never want to hear from us again, mail in this card. The opt-in group got the letter in the mail, and they got a card that said, if you want to do the survey, mail it in and we'll send it to you. Or tell us you don't want to be, you don't want us to contact you. So how did these two methods compare? The survey response rate was higher with opt-out method, 40 versus 26%. Declining to participate by returning the card was higher in the opt-in group, more people declined. The response time was much longer, 24 days versus 16 days for the opt-in method. Distress or complaints was no different between the two methods. Response bias, well, the people who had to opt in, they had to actually send in the card. When they answered the questions, these were people who were caring for their loved one at home, and they were more likely to report insufficient support at home. So they more likely were dissatisfied people. So we could see here, your recruitment method could, you know, the method you use can in part determine the findings you get. So it turned out the people who were willing to take the time to mail the card and opt in tended to be more dissatisfied people who were willing to take the time. So just to summarize this opt-in versus opt-out, the opt-out may have more informed decision-making because people actually get the research materials, the survey, or whatever it is the research process is. It does not appear to be associated with higher levels of distress. It's a more efficient recruitment method. It was associated in this study with a higher response rate. The opt-in method, that extra step to opt-in may be a barrier to research participation, potentially threatening. Okay, I want to talk a little bit about, because this is a common question your IRBs will ask, when should bereaved individuals be recruited to research? When is it okay? Well, I would say it depends on the research question and should be tightly tied to the research question. Participant choice in timing, if possible, is good. Okay? If they participate earlier, there's better recall, you have more accurate contact information so you can find them. Later participation is more time they have to reflect on their events and experiences, but you know, and potentially less distress. You want to avoid special dates, as I mentioned, birthdays, death dates. If you don't know, you can consider a pilot study. So with the pilot study, you would have a longer period of bereavement before contacting the parents, and then as part of that pilot, you ask them, how soon could I have contacted you? That's another way that some people have done it. So I'm going to take a little bit of time on this slide, not too much, but I want to show you what I mean by saying that timing of contacting the bereaved families is related to the research objective. So in this first study by Dr. Sharman, his goal was to study the factors that parents think about when they're making a decision in the ICU to limit or withdraw life support from their child. And probably, as some of you know, over 60% of children who die in ICUs die after the family and physicians have made a decision to withdraw life support. And this tends to be a short process in time. There's a conversation, decisions are made, and then once the decision's made and life support is withdrawn, death is fairly imminent. So in order to study the decision-making process, Dr. Sharman interviewed people right before the conversations, and this was you know, within a week before the death, or most of the interviews were conducted at the time of death, on the same day as the death. Bronisser and colleagues wanted to study the feasibility of collecting pontine glioma tumor tissue at autopsy. So they had to recruit their parents either right before the death or right after the death because the autopsies were conducted 8 hours after the death. So again, recruitment was tied to the research question. Buckley was interested in studying cardiovascular risk factors after the glioma's death. The highest period of risk is 2 weeks after the death. So we had to recruit the family members within those 2 weeks so that they could undergo the Holter EKG monitoring to study the risk factors. In one of my own studies, I just studied the the feasibility of conducting a physician-parent follow-up meeting after a child's death in the ICU. And in preliminary work, most parents suggested a meeting at around 1 month's time after the death would be best. So when we tried to do our feasibility study, or we did our feasibility study, we recruited parents at about 1 month after the death. So I think maybe I've gone through enough examples, but you can see the research question should be primarily what's driving when you contact the parents. What about consenting bereaved individuals to research? Well, I would recommend, and the literature would recommend, process consent. And you know, this is true for any research we do, but particularly with bereaved parents, meaning that they're going to listen to you, sign the consent form, but at every step along the way, you're confirming that they still want to participate. We have to respect the decision not to participate, and that's respecting passive refusals. So if you're doing, you know, with your research group, you're going to think about ahead of time, okay, we know passive refusals will happen. How many phone calls will we make? How many messages will we leave? What is the script for those messages? And when do we say, well, this is a passive refusal? Giving people control over some of the participation can also be helpful. Letting them know they can skip a question. If you're audio recording or video recording, you can stop the recording, you can take a break. This is a little different than biomedical research, where we're like so strict on following the protocols here. We want to give people options when we can, but we do have to be careful because that could influence our results. And then when we're consenting bereaved individuals, we have to just think about whether it's one parent, both parents, or maybe co-parent consent, because one parent may be participating at the request of the other. And when that happens, you don't get really good data, so you want to make sure people are voluntarily participating. Data collection, providing options and the effect on research findings. So, you know, you can give people the option about the type of contact. Do you want to participate in the research in person, telephone, over the internet? You know, you could imagine that a survey, for example, could be done in any way, or maybe an interview. People who participate in person might be a little different than people who want to participate over the phone, so it might affect your findings. It might be harder. Parents might not want to come back to the hospital where their child died. Some authors recommend giving the bereaved individual a choice of place of where the research would take place. And most bereavement researches, you know, interviews and focus groups and surveys. I have always conducted the research in the hospital setting. And if parents don't want to come back but they want to participate, I've arranged another place on the medical campus, either the medical school or a conference room in the research building. Because if a parent is coming back to the hospital, I have the resources in the hospital. So if I needed a chaplain, or a social worker, or the psychologist, or the security guard, or the emergency room, these people are already in place. Or if I were going to somebody's home, like some investigators said, well, you could give them that option and go to the home, you don't have that in place. And you may also have to have a little bit of concern. I mean, I come from Detroit, going into people's homes and research your safety. The other thing about having people come to the hospital is that I can prepare the environment. So if I'm going to be audio recording or video recording, I got it all arranged. I have, you know, snacks for the parents. I have everything arranged ahead of time. So although the literature says give them an option about place, I would recommend they come to. Timing we've already talked about should be linked to the research question. But you have to be prepared that, you know, you might have to, or people may want to participate in the evening or only on Saturday or only on Sunday afternoon. So there needs to be a lot of flexibility there. If both parents want to participate, well, usually we request they participate as individuals. If you get both parents together, sometimes only one wants to do the talking and you don't hear from the other one. The other thing you have to think about, if both parents participate, they're not independent of each other and you need to consider that in your analysis. If you can offer the research to bereaved individuals in their preferred language, you will have better recruitment and more meaningful data. Now, this is hard for the researchers because, of course, you have to have everything translated, you have to have they're translated, we're doing interviews. In our critical care network, we've done all of our research in English and Spanish, but there is an expense to it. And then giving the parents some control over participation and evaluation. What about managing emotional risks? Well, we're going to do that really first by realizing that there are emotional risks to participating in bereavement research. And it's important that the investigator realize that and that we put it in the consent form. And that we tell the parents that as well, or the other bereaved individuals, because then So if I know about it, then I can prepare for that as a researcher. If the bereaved individuals know about it, they can kind of prepare themselves. And if they know that I know, then if there's some emotional expression, say during an interview or a research procedure, they don't have to feel embarrassed. Another way to manage emotional risk is to always remember that empathic rapport with our participants. So this is things like if a person comes meeting them at the door, walking them to the conference room, introducing the research team again, letting the parents introduce themselves, letting them have a few minutes to tell their story, being comfortable with periods of silence, letting them ask you some questions, attention to your tone of voice and your body language. All these things go into empathic rapport. While at the same time, we have to remember as bereavement researchers, we are researchers. Our goal is to collect data and create generalizable knowledge. We're not the therapist or the clinician taking care of this family, but that doesn't mean we don't have that empathic rapport. Another way to manage emotional risks is to have well-trained research staff. We'll talk a little bit about that in a future slide. Providing bereavement support information. Typically, I would do this right when I'm sending contact letters to parents. I send them information about what our hospital has to offer. So whether or not they participate in research, they have something. Making referrals when you think they're needed or when parents ask to different support groups in the community. I would suggest, that's a little hard because these groups kind of pretend to be very fluid and it's hard to know everything where people live. But having one person maybe at your hospital, a social worker or chaplain who could help you with that you could refer to, and then that person can take the time to look into what's available in that parent's community. Researcher follow-up is important. Giving the person a phone call a couple days later to see how they're doing or sending them a thank you card. And having emergency plans in place. So depending on what you're doing, your IRB may ask for an emergency plan. This may be anything from like having, if I can give you an example, having a social worker that a parent said during an interview they have a plan to hurt themselves or others. And I have someone I can contact who can make an assessment, who can make a referral. One of my projects, I had to have a 24/7 emergency mental health services know what I was doing so they could be available. Even though your research assistants knowing that if someone said they're immediately going to kill myself, that they should call the police. And these things are put in the consent form in, you know, kind of a nice, subtle way, but they should be there because if someone did tell you something and you had to go through this process, you're breaking that confidentiality that you promised the bereaved individual. So you want to put it in the consent form so that they will know about it ahead of time. What about managing confidentiality? Of course, we use all the usual methods with coded identifiers and destroying audio tapes and videotapes. I would just caution on care with personal stories. The NIH in particular now has a lot of emphasis on creating public use data sets for funded research so that when, you know, if the researchers do a project, once those initial papers are written, that data has to be made publicly available. So we've done this in our critical care network. So with our bereavement projects, any de-identified quantitative data we've put in public use data sets, but so far we've gotten away with not our qualitative data. Personal stories, and even though we cannot de-identify a transcript, parents might recognize themselves in the stories that they tell. So we have a lot of caution with that. An NIH certificate of confidentiality can be useful. Now, if you're doing any NIH-funded research since, I think, October 2017, the NIH will automatically give a certificate of confidentiality. But what this is a way that your research data is not subject to any forced disclosure. So this became very important for me doing my study of follow-up meetings between physicians and bereaved parents. Because it was the physicians who were worried. If they're on a videotape, and I was videotaping these interactions, videotaping parents and physicians having this follow-up meeting, discussing autopsies and all this kind of thing, the physicians were concerned that maybe parents could use that videotape in a malpractice case. So by having a certificate of confidentiality, the physicians were more comfortable. And you have to remind people too, if you're doing co-parent interviews or focus groups, that it's hard to maintain confidentiality because, you know, you tell people at the start of your focus group that the conversation is confidential and you hope they don't share it with others. What types of designs are used for bereavement research? Well, really all different types of designs. You know, people, retrospective and prospective, or both, where people are asked to think back about their experiences and then follow them in the future for their health outcomes, their factors: quantitative surveys, qualitative interviews, and focus groups. But I would say intervention studies are rare, and they're needed, and there are probably more now than there used to be, but there are issues with randomization and with control, so we have to have somewhat creative research designs. This quote has a slide by Margaret Strobe, kind of a well-known grief researcher, and she writes, "As researchers, we have an obligation to examine the efficacy of bereavement intervention programs, for it's unethical to offer help that has not been proven to be helpful." And this little figure here is a model that she's developed for adaptive coping with grief, that bereaved individuals have to kind of oscillate between confronting and avoiding the loss, loss-oriented stressors, and then the restoration-oriented stressors. So loss-oriented stressors are like yearning for the disease, dealing with the death, and the restoration-oriented is more ongoing life, going back to work, going back to school, resuming your old responsibilities. We know that RCTs provide a high level of evidence regarding benefits and harms of new interventions, but can we really randomize bereaved individuals to an intervention or a control? It's a little hard because people who agree to participate in trials that are bereaved are often seeking help themselves. So you have a choice. There's a no intervention control, which I would say is really hard to achieve because if you have an intervention and your control group is going to get nothing, if they wanted support, they may go and try to find it someplace else in the community, which will increase the difference between your two groups. The other thing is, even if they don't, and it really is a no control, the researcher has to follow these people to assess their outcomes. So if you're consenting people, and then you're following them at whatever, 1 month and 6 months and a year, or having them fill surveys or whatever, those people bond with the researchers. And that collecting of outcomes becomes a form of intervention in itself because of that relationship that you could have them do a different intervention, so you can have one, you know, one and compare to another. In the study I mentioned with the elderly widows and widowers by Caserta, there we're randomizing people to two interventions, one where they had a support that was loss-oriented coping and the other that was loss and restoration-oriented. You could also have a waitlist control where all participants receive the intervention, but some wait till the study's over, and they serve as a control group during the study period. So these are the common things that you'll see in the literature. Now why, you know, should we try to do these trials? I mean, this is a study that was from 2017 that I thought was very interesting. It's from France, 22 adult ICUs in France. And they were studying the effect of a condolence letter written by the physician and nurse on the grief symptoms of the relatives of the patient who died in the ICU. So the intervention was a condolence letter or no condolence letter. And the condolence letter was supposed to, you know, recognize the bereaved individual, say something nice about them, recognize a family, express sympathy, offer support. And then they followed these families at 1 month with this possible anxiety and depression scale, and then at 6 months with the same scale, measuring anxiety and depression, this impact of event scale, which looks at post-traumatic stress symptoms, and inventory of complicated grief, which measures maladaptive. At 1 month, they didn't find any real differences between the two groups, although there were some trends. But by 6 months, they found that the people who got the condolence letter actually had more anxiety and depression as measured by the HAD scale. They had more depression on the depression subscale. They had more patients that got the, or parents or family members that got the condolence letter that met their criteria for high levels of depression and cut off the LDL. They had more that had post-traumatic stress symptoms. So they concluded here, you know, who would think, why should you study sending a nice condolence letter to the families of the patients you take care of? But what they concluded here, that it didn't help them. And they don't advise sending a condolence letter as the only means of support. This is an example of a trial that used a waitlist control. So this is a study of a bereavement intervention for female adolescents in South Africa. And in South Africa, there are about 4 million, apparently, children who have lost one or both parents, primarily due to AIDS. So these researchers had this eight-session bereavement support group, and they compared it to a waitlist control. And they measured grief symptoms in the adolescents, depression symptoms, and then they had their caregivers measure behavior problems. So the waitlist control didn't get the intervention until later on. So these researchers said, well, the waitlist control is probably okay because they were doing the intervention 4.5 years on average after the parent's death. So the waitlist control only had to wait another 6 months. So here they felt, well, we'll do the waitlist control because we don't want to withhold the intervention. And what they found was that the Korb-Ruppman item scale measures normative grief, and so the change from baseline to after the intervention was no difference between the control and the intervention group. But the complicated grief scales showed a decline in complicated grief symptoms more in the intervention group. The depression scale showed a greater decline in depression in the intervention group, and the behavioral problems completed by the caregiver showed a greater decline in the intervention group. These authors caution that if you use a waitlist control, there may be a nocebo effect, meaning that there may be negative effects among people who know they're going to get something, they're anticipating intervention, but they're waiting for it. And so if they are actually doing a little worse off because they're waiting for something, that might increase the difference between your intervention and control group. So you can see there's have to be some creativity if you're going to do a randomized control trial on how to think about your study design. I just mentioned a little bit about suicide bereavement research. There are nearly 1 million suicide deaths globally. Bereavement researchers feel, if you're studying grief among families whose loved one died of suicide, it's even more difficult to feel the feelings of guilt, blame, rejection. Ethics committees often have a lot to say about this kind of research. This researcher, Warren Collies, their paper is about what do these suicide researchers do when they're faced with questions from the IRB that they feel is interfering with their work and putting too many restrictions on their work. Most commonly, Dr. Moore reports that they provide evidence to address the assumptions of the IRBs, demonstrate safety and appropriateness of methods. They confirm the researcher qualifications and training, and when necessary, they change the project to meet the IRB's. Because asking about suicide, though, induce suicide ideation. So Dazi and colleagues did this literature review of, they found 13 papers that examined whether asking about suicide induced suicide ideation among adolescents and adults in the at-risk population and the general population. And they found no significant increase. So in conclusion, they concluded that talking about suicide may reduce rather than increase suicide ideation. Now, what about ethical considerations when bereaved individuals are invited in error to participate in research? It can happen when you work in an intensive care, for example, and you're following up with people. This Dr. Wakefield and colleagues who published this paper is a cancer survivorship researcher. And he explains, or she, I don't know, explains that doing research to try to understand the long-term psychological, medical, physical effects of childhood cancer later on in life. And sometimes they would be sending a letter to the home, the family home, and that individual who was a child with cancer survivor had a late mortality and died. So they're suggesting if this happens, the principal investigator should send an apology letter to the family. They should provide support for the research staff. And this is really important because it's the research staff who are going to get the angry call from the parent or family member. And ultimately, he suggests that the design of long-term follow-up studies in cancer should include survivors as well as bereaved families. Right? That may be a little difficult, but that's his ultimate suggestion. I want to mention the bracelet study. I think this is pertinent for people who work in intensive care and are not interested really in bereavement research. But the bracelet study is asking the question about how do we consider bereavement in the context of any randomized controlled trial in an ICU setting. So, in the ICU, most of the research we do in my ICU is drugs and devices and, ventilators and these kinds of things, and children still die, and they die in the context of these trials. So this was done in UK, and it was a survey of the RCT activity in PICUs and NICUs in a certain time period. They looked at mortality rates and provisions for. They conducted qualitative interviews with bereaved parents and clinicians, and this was really a methodological study to inform future research. The investigators found that there were 50 RCTs that include 30,000 children during this time period. The death rate in the NICU trials was 17%. The death rate in the PICU trials was 6%. Trial-related decisions were often made during time of crisis. So, you know, this is, should I participate in the trial, should I come out of the trial? And the range of bereavement strategies that were incorporating these trials was very wide, ranged from nothing to a multi-part plan for the bereaved families. So the investigators concluded that there should be a coordinated response to bereavement that's right there at trial inception. When you're doing research in the ICU and some of your patients are expected to die. And that more research is needed on bereavement experiences after trial. So one trial that I participated in, the ZAPA trials, is a trial of therapeutic hypothermia versus normal thermia after cardiac arrest and pediatric intensive care. And here about half the children that were in this, the study was also conducted here at Hopkins, it was a multi-center study. But about half the children in the study died. I mean, it's cardiac arrest research, right? It's post-arrest care. So I would say a little bit I missed the opportunity here because we could have incorporated some bereavement interventions right at trial inception, which we didn't do. But as we went through the trial, and of course as you operationalize things, you learn a lot, we did decide as a group to send a letter to the families of the children who were in the trial to tell them what the trial results were. And knowing that half of those parents were bereaved, at least at my site, we also sent a little handwritten note on the side, just acknowledging your child's death, just acknowledging the death and expressing sympathy and giving support and gratitude for participation in the ZAPA trials. What are bereaved parents' recommendations for grief research? This is from a study by Dyergrov. It says, parents want to be contacted by letter when being approached for the first time. They want to give us a thorough and written information before research participation. Let us decide where and when to meet. I already spoke a little bit about the where to meet. I would suggest doing it someplace where you have control of the environment. Listening respectfully to mementos we find relevant to show or tell you about. Almost always when a bereaved parent comes, a participating person, they bring things with them. Either a big framed photograph of your child, which they put on the table while they're doing the interview, or they bring their photo albums and they want you to take the time to. Give us enough time and quietness for the interview. I think working with bereaved parents, they won't be able to tell you how much time is enough, but they can tell you when they feel rushed. So, you know, we need to make sure we have adequate time. And let us meet trained interviewers with knowledge of the bereavement process. Conduct the interview in an empathic and cautious way. Give us the opportunity to reflect and ask questions during and after the interview. Some of us might need extra time and care before, during, and after the interview. Offer follow-up after the interview, information, contact the health professionals. Discuss the results with some of us if possible, and send us a report and let us read it and give feedback. So these are suggestions from bereaved parents themselves. This idea of sharing the results with the parents for feedback, this is done sometimes in qualitative research, we call it member checking, where we ask certain members that were participants to look at our results and just give your impression about how the researchers have interpreted them. It can enrich the data and the analysis and interpretation. So I just take a few minutes to talk about are there risks to bereavement researchers. And there is a body of literature on vicarious trauma, primarily in the nursing literature. Vicarious trauma is a sort of secondary traumatic stress that comes from prolonged engagement with emotionally challenging data. It can lead to depression, burnout, frustration, alienation, etc., job stress. This role conflict can be difficult. A lot of times, people who become research coordinators and do this kind of work at one time were nurses or were ICU nurses in my situation. They're very used to being the clinician and talking to people and giving advice. And here they have their research role where their role really is to collect data and help to create generalizable knowledge. So they have to understand that role. And then, risks of personal safety if you're going into people's homes. This is a little little figure from Taylor and colleagues that talks about vicarious trauma for bereavement researchers. On the x-axis, on one extreme, there's research that's being not very sensitive. And on the other extreme, it's research that's very sensitive. And the top part is if you're very close to the data. So if you're a research assistant doing one-on-one interviews in person with bereaved people, listening to their personal stories, you're very close to the data. If you're maybe a research assistant who's entering survey data into a computer, you're a little farther away from data. So what these authors suggest is the closer you are to the data and the more sensitive it is, the more the risk for vicarious trauma. And they suggest that research on violence and abuse and on bereavement are the two research areas that have the highest risk for vicarious trauma. Managing risk to bereavement researchers. Researcher qualifications, of course, are very important, and everyone doesn't have the same qualifications, so it's important to have a team where people have their role. So, in one of my studies where I was conducting focus groups, we had myself who looked at the records, got the contact information, took the letters. I had a chaplain who called and recruited parents who was a member of the research team. We had a medical anthropologist who facilitated the focus groups. We had a nursing professor who was there to support parents during the focus groups. So everybody had their special qualifications to fill that role. Training of your research team is really important. These are some of the ways that I have used didactics or lecturing, modeling. We've made audio tapes, videotapes of researchers interacting with actors, showing our research assistants what the interaction should look like. Role play, where we give the research assistants, the PI, a multi-center study, we give them a scenario and have them interact with each other to practice, and then verification of skills. I've had a lot of research assistants call me on the phone to interview me, pretending I'm the bereaved parent, just so that they can practice. And then support. I think this is not the type of research, if you're going to do it, that the PI can just hand over the protocol to your research team and walk away. There has to be a lot of mentoring and supervision. It's very important in our multi-center network, the research coordinators bond with each other so that they have the supportive network. If you get a difficult case or someone is very distraught on the phone, you have someone to talk to. Some recommend journaling, having debriefing sessions, professional counseling if needed, and sometimes just taking a break and having a little time away from research. So in conclusion, I talk fast, I've said a lot, but research participants are at risk for emotional and psychological stress. Most find research participation to be a positive experience overall. Distress from participation appears to be short-lived. Careful attention to the research process in terms of approach, timing, consent, data collection, empathic interactions, careful personal stories is key in minimizing participant distress. Research staff may experience adverse consequences, which may be reduced with training and support. So I'm going to stop here. I'll be happy to answer any questions. Parents or guardians, the way I would handle it is let the parents who want to participate, participate. And in fact, if they all want to, when we did the research, the follow-up meetings, people participated as couples and families. They could bring relatives. If I were doing an other type of interview or survey, I would actually ask the parents to participate as individuals. Because what I found is, if I have both parents there and we're conducting an interview, one may do all the talking, or one may just feel that they have to say what the other one wants to hear. So I found to get the most meaningful and richest data by having people participate as individuals. Now you have to remember, in qualitative or quantitative research, those people are not
they're not independent of each other, right? So in your quantitative statistics, you have to take into account of that, and even in your qualitative analyses, that they have many similar experiences.
Could you speak just a little more on religion and spirituality and what your experience has been in participants who are of one particular religion, particularly who believe that children are now fine and in heaven? How often do we run into that kind of circumstance? And how you find out about that in the first place?
You know, that's a very interesting question to me. And, you know, one of the projects I didn't intend to do when I started it. The project that I mentioned about learning how to do follow-up meetings with parents whose children died, I had thought, you know, we designed all this. We had interviewed physicians. We had interviewed parents. We had interviewed other types of health professionals. We had a communication specialist work with us. We had a medical anthropologist work for us. And we came up with this kind of framework for how to meet with parents and conduct a follow-up meeting, review the autopsy report, answer their questions, all this kind of stuff. And I'm grateful that I videotaped these interactions because we did a secondary analysis of this same data. And although the doctors did what they were asked to do, then the parents asked questions we thought, when we went back and looked at these, we had maybe 35 or so video recorded interactions, we really learned that parents were trying to make sense and find meaning in their experiences. And that sense-making and meaning-making was highly spiritual for many parents. So, and actually we wrote about that. So there was the type of, you know, this is more, I guess, more spiritual than religious, but there is the types of meaning-making. First was sense-making. How do you just make sense out of what happened? Whether you're making sense out of it biologically or biblically, you know, this was God's will, whatever. The other type of meaning making after sense making was benefit finding. And that's a weird word for it, you know, to think about benefit with a child's death, but that's how the bereavement literature refers to it. But it's really trying to, what good could come out of this? So parents also thought of that in a spiritual way, like God allowed this to happen. And how can this change me for the better? What is the benefit? This is where the altruism comes in. If you've been participating in research, or parents will volunteer, or parents will adopt, or parents will do all kinds of things to bring some goodness out of their child's death. The third type of meaning making was this idea that I mentioned of continuing bonds. Very interesting how parents try to maintain that bond with their child. You think that child dies, they're still the parent, right? And they still, the relationship now is different, but there is still a relationship, even though that child is in heaven. And then the fourth way was of meaning making was identity reconstruction. Who am I now that my child is gone? I've lost that very important role. And that is also very spiritual for many parents. So, you know, I was very surprised that even in that 1 to 2 hour, you know, they're mostly about an hour, maybe an hour and a half, interactions that these bereaved parents had with their physicians and other health professionals, that this spirituality and meaning making came out. So I think it's a very important topic and we need to learn more about it. Yes?
I have a question about passive refusal. You talked a little bit about that. Can you describe a little bit more kind of how many phone calls or contacts you think means that the person is passively refusing to participate in research, and if you think that's different at all in bereavement research versus research perhaps with survivors of cardiac arrest where the children might have had devastating outcomes if the parents are grieving but the child is still.
Yeah, I think the question, yeah, is about when is something a passive refusal? It's hard to say. And, if it's a single center study and I'm doing it myself, I get a feel for it. But the problem is, with our critical care network, we do multi-center research. So one thing I don't do, because the research coordinator is like, how many times? If I say call 3 times and no more, they'll call 3 times, I'll call it. 110, 112, 115, my three calls are done and I'm done. This person is a passive refuser. Why? Because that is the most stressful part of the research, because you don't know how the person's going to respond when they pick up the phone. I always felt it's the most stressful part and the most rewarding part, because you're scared because of the unpredictability of who's going to answer the phone. But then most of the time when you talk to the people, they're so just, they're grateful to even have that interaction. So it's also a very rewarding part. So it's hard to say three times or four times. So, and it's more, even more complicated than this. But I would tell people to call at different times, you know, and sometimes we have to give people an afternoon off during the week so that they can make calls on Saturday or Sunday. It's also complicated because what if nobody answers? Then you don't know if they even got the message. Or what if somebody answers? Or you leave a message, what message do you leave, and how many times do you leave a message? What we've done is have some scripts ahead of time. This helps people to what to leave on the message. And, you know, we wouldn't leave more than three messages if there's actually a message machine there. So we encourage people to make several calls. I don't usually put a number on it, to call at different times of the day, to call, you know, to keep notes on when you call, so that if you called on Tuesday at 1 o'clock, the next time you call might be in the evening or on a weekend. That you follow your scripts, and if you call somebody, you call them more than once and they're mad, and they say, why did you call me? Then you apologize and you say, you're sorry, you won't call you again. I know that's not what you want to hear. You want me to tell you, you should call this many times and say this and it'll all be perfect. But that it's I think it's a difficult question.
So I'll take I'll take the chance to ask the last question. So I was really interested in the study that looked at outcomes of families who had gotten the letter. And that families who had gotten the letter a month after their child's death were more likely to have depression, anxiety, and PTSD. And that made me think about the study that Randy Curtis and his group did in Seattle, where they trained clinicians to in end-of-life communication skills. And then they surveyed the families, and some of the clinicians had gotten the skills training and some didn't. And the families who had conversation with those who had gotten the skills training were more depressed. And so the conclusion of the study was, well, maybe teaching people to have better end-of-life conversations was a bad thing. And that sort of hits me as funny, just in the way that sending a bereavement letter causes more distress hits me as funny. And I guess my question about it is, how adequate do you feel that the current outcome measures are for the specific situation of, for instance, bereavement? Are we sure we're measuring what we want to be measuring, or are we adapting measures for other things for this special situation?
Well, outcome measures are also very, you know, very important, which ones we choose. I think I presented this particular study to you as an example to show you why studying interventions are important, because you might get a result that you didn't expect. And I think even these authors here were cautious, that they said, you know, it's not that the bereavement letter is bad. They said the bereavement letter by itself probably is not going to help people, okay? Do I think that, you know, training people in communication is going to make them have more grief? I don't think so. So the question of the outcomes is very important. And there are, you know, one of the things that I have found with working with bereaved parents, when we use these scales, bereaved parents often have a ceiling effect. Okay, so this core bereavement items or revised inventory of grief, these different things. So all the parents are at the very hot top of the scale, so that you can't really see the variation, but you need to see variation if you're going to show a difference between your groups. So people then move into using these more complicated, what's called complicated grief or maladaptive grief. They're a little bit different scales, and they look at maladaptive symptoms to grief because the spread, especially with parents, of scores is more, and you can look for differences. But I'm not sure if measuring maladaptive grief is really the best outcome, right, for families. it's maybe more subtle things, right? So do we need better outcome measures? Yes, probably. Yes, likely.
Yeah. All right, well, please join me in thanking Dr. Beard.